was, have been mentored by really for 22 years at this point. And our goal today is to, there are some experts in the room, so I'm not talking to you, but I say this is the goal, all right? But the goal is to take people who are not experts in HPSG from some understanding of syntax from some other framework to able to follow our conference. It's an ambitious goal, all right? And then also to give you a flavor of what this framework can do. I recognize this is an ambitious goal, but my hope is that it's the sort of goal where if we get only partway there, it's still useful. So we've had some technical difficulties, but hopefully this works. So we're going to do, or this is for my half. I'm going to do HPSG theory, and then after a break, about an hour and a half in, Dan's going to take over and show you some of the implementation and what HPSG has led to through one specific implementation in the Lingo project. So in this introduction, I'm going to give you a slide of shared assumptions, stuff that I think you already know from elsewhere, and then sort of a high-level overview of the hour and a half that I'm doing. And then I'm going to spend the bulk of my time on six key ideas of HPSG, where I'm going to take you through...
Mute.
Is it muted?
No.
Nope.
It's just a heavy part of the...
West
Coast.
Thank you. All right. Thank you. So take you through, I have two example sentences, and we're going to see the analysis of those sentences in more and more detail as we go through the different key ideas. Then at the end, I have a couple of short things, one on the theoretical commitments of HPSG, and that's actually just one slide, and then some talk about extensions that will help hopefully bridge to what's going on in the conference over the weekend. And I have some slides on my project, the Grammar Matrix, but that's going to be the first casualty of time if we end up not doing as much as I'm hoping to in what was 90 minutes, and I have 100 slides, so that's kind of silly. Despite having just told you that I have 100 slides for 90 minutes, and despite talking really fast, I'm going to try to speak slowly, I encourage questions. So I'm very comfortable only getting through as much of this as I have time to do while answering your questions. So here are the shared assumptions. I'm assuming that everyone in this room is familiar with these ideas, though you might not necessarily agree with them. So we are taking a generative approach to syntax, and by generative approach, I mean we are building formal models of linguistic knowledge that allow us to test what sentences would be generated by that model. I'm also assuming a distinction between competence and performance, and we're talking about building a model of linguistic competence, that is linguistic knowledge, that would interact with models of performance for parsing and generation and other things. I'm assuming we're interested in modeling grammaticality, and we end up modeling that as a very sharp distinction because our unification operation makes very sharp distinctions about in versus out. I'm also assuming that everyone in this room is interested in modeling semantic compositionality, that is how we build up semantic representations for complex sentences based on the semantics of their parts. That everyone's familiar with the notion of constituent structure and parts of speech, and something like X-bar theory. So to pause for questions, any questions about these concepts? Okay, and I guess, Sahar, are you monitoring online if there's questions that come into the chat? Excellent. So online people, you're welcome to ask questions too.
Okay.
So here are the six key ideas that I promised that I'm going to go through in more detail as I go, but first sort of one sentence definition of each. The first one is HPSG is a monostratal theory of grammar. That means for a given sentence, we do one processing step that brings us to the elaborated representation. Idea number two, we look at language as a system of signs, that is, words and constructions and phrases built up out of words and constructions are all pairings of form and meaning, all the way down. We use typed feature structures. I don't have a one-sentence definition of those, but I'll get back to them. Our main operation is unification, that is, we combine our typed feature structures or typed feature structure descriptions via unification, which is an operation of taking information from two different places, putting them together, seeing if they conflict, and if not, finding out what the result is. We'll do some of that. We have this key idea of strong lexicalism, that is, the lexicon carries the bulk of the information, both in terms of rich lexical entries and in terms of lexical rules that derive further lexemes or words from the lexical entries. And then finally, HPSG is interested in capturing generalizations of different granularities. We want to get the big picture generalizations about, say, SVO word order in a language, and also down to the last little idiosyncratic idiom, all in one consistent theory of grammar for that language. So this is where we're going. So we're diving now in detail into the key ideas point there. And the first one is the monostratal theory of grammar. See, 100 slides, no problem, when they go by that fast. All right, so the key idea here, monostratal theory of grammar, is that we are pairing a string with one detailed, elaborate structure. And this contrasts with sequences of structures that you would get in a transformation-based approach. Right? And the benefits to this is, well, many, but here are three. One is that it potentially enables us to integrate with incremental parsing models. So we know that when people are understanding language, they don't wait until a whole sentence is in to begin building a model of what it is that they're hearing. That goes word by word. And so if we have an all-at-once kind of model of grammar, then we have a chance of doing that. Not that I can hand you an incremental parser for HPSG, but the possibility is open, right? Also, we think it is more compatible with psycholinguistic studies of language processing. And here I would refer you to Tom Wasso and other colleagues who've, there's a Sagan Wasso reference later that points into that literature. And finally, it's process independent. So something that is monostratal is open to being order independent. So we have constraints that are combined in whatever order, which means we can use one and the same competence grammar for different performance tasks. And that includes parsing and generation, but also other things we do with our linguistic knowledge, like generating grammaticality judgments, making puns, doing crossword puzzles, etc. So process independent, order independent, monostratal theory of grammar. So what does this mean? Here's my first view of my first example sentence. Kim relies on Sandy. And this is a simplified view of the analysis because each of those node labels actually hides a very large feature structure. And we're going to see it in more detail as we go. But it is just that. All right? This is the only tree structure for this analysis of this sentence. And I think this sentence might actually be unambiguous, but you'd be surprised at how ambiguous things are, and Dan will show us some of that later. And part of that analysis, part of that big feature structure, is semantic representations of each node. And on the S node at the very top of the tree, we have a semantic representation that looks like this. And at this point, I want to pause and tell you that the trees and semantic structures that I'm showing you here are not absolute truth HPSG trees and semantic representations, because there is no such thing. Right? This is an active research community. There's not one version of it. But what I'm working from here is the grammar in the Sagan-Wasso-Benger textbook so that I could be sure that I was presenting you something that's at least internally consistent. So there's a grammar fragment there that I'm using with some slight modifications in order to bring the semantic representation slightly more in line with what you're going to see in the English resource grammar. So it's Sagan-Wasso-Benger tweaked slightly in the direction of the English resource grammar and hopefully still internally consistent. So Kim relies on Sandy, that's the simple version of that. Here is a partially unabbreviated version of it, where I'm starting to show you the feature structures on the nodes. And I'm not going to tell you the details about this right now, but that's where I'm going over the next 70 or so minutes at this point. We're also going to have fun with a more complex example. These cookies, Kim knew, were baked by Sandy. This example illustrates both passive and English focus movement, often mislabeled topicalization. And if you're used to transformational versions of syntax, you might wonder how we could possibly do those two things without movement. And I'm happy to say that I can show you that today. So these are our examples. And likewise, we have semantics at the S node for that more complicated example. And I think the main thing to see here is we have predicate argument structure. All right? So that first thing is the relation for no. And it relates X2, which is the thing named Kim, with E3, which is the bake relation. And the bake relation relates X4, which is Sandy, and cookie, and then that proximal is my representation of these. I would love to turn that off.
I'll work on that problem.
Okay.
Let me carry on.
I will move slightly over. Hopefully it's not bothering people too much, just me. All right, so just to give you a taste of where this is going, this is a partially unabbreviated version of the more complex example, and you'll see that I've shown you features called specifier and gap, and they have this boxed one in them, and that's showing structure sharing. There's some information that's identified across this tree between the specifier of baked and the VP headed by BATE, and then the value of GAP, which has to do with our analysis of long-distance dependencies, on WER, that's passed up the tree and then finally identified with these cookies. We'll see that in a bit more detail as we go. Now, so, back to the overview of this key idea, we are pairing each analysis pairs a string with one detailed, elaborate representation, and I'm careful to say each analysis because we will often find many different analyses for the same string. So an analysis is a pairing of a string and a structure. So we are not doing any movement, we're not doing any transformations, there's not sequences of representations, there's one representation. Questions at this point? If this were a class I was teaching, I would feel bad that you're not asking me questions, but we have a lot to do, so I'm not going to feel bad, I'm going to keep going. The next key idea is the notion that language is a system of signs, and this is very much inspired by de Saussure. If you look in Pollard and Sog 94, for example, there's a nice long discussion there. And the idea here is that words and phrases are both modeled as pairings of form and meaning, and that means that phrase structure rules are also pairings of what you might say as constraints on form and constraints on meaning. And in the formalism from the Sargasso-Bender textbook, part of this information is abstracted out into principles. So instead of having each phrase structure rule show the constraints on meaning that do the semantic composition, we have the semantic compositionality principle and the semantic inheritance principle, which ought to be on the next slide. Nope, they're much later. We'll get to them. So the benefits of this is that we have a model of local compositionality, which is compatible with the rule-to-rule principle, if that means anything to you. So at each step in the derivation, we are saying, here's how the meanings of the pieces, plus this way that we're putting them together, makes the meanings of this larger piece, and that goes on up the tree. This contrasts, again, with other frameworks of syntax, where you don't have partial meaning representations, you have the whole LF for the whole sentence, but there's not really a sense of, here's the semantics for this part of it, at least as far as I know. And that allows us to do semantic and pragmatic processing of fragments, which is really important, for example, in dialogue systems where a lot of what's going on is just fragments. So here's the simple example again, and here's the lexical entries involved in this simple example. So remember I said words are pairings of form and meaning. The form here is both the orthography slash phonology kin, but we're representing it as orthography, and then the syn for syntax part of the structure. So the form of this is the orthography kin, the fact that it is nouny, and the fact that it is not looking for any specifiers or complements. It's fully saturated on its own because it's a proper noun. The meaning part of it says, my contribution to the meaning of the sentence is one predication, which is the named relation, that relates the entity denoted by X with the name kin. And the fact that I'm going to expose that X in my index feature so that other things can grab hold of that in the composition. This is a relatively simple pairing of form and meaning. The one for Sandy looks an awful lot like it, right? Two lexical entries, okay, nothing new there. Just being thorough. Here's the lexical entry for rely, and it says in its semantics that it's contributing one predication, which is actually the rely on predication, because this is the kind of verb that idiosyncratically selects for a PP complement with a certain preposition down inside of it, and on our analysis, that preposition is actually semantically empty, and all the semantics is coming with the verb. And it's got, in that predication, three arguments. The first is the situation of someone relying on someone, that's the E here. And then the other two are linked to the specifier and the complement. So the semantic side is that predication. The form side is, again, the orthography rely, and then the syntactic information. It's a verb. It's looking for one specifier, which is a noun phrase, and one complement, which is a prepositional phrase, and it's grabbing hold of their indices so it can link them to its own semantics. Questions? Am I talking too fast? All right. If I am, you can make this sign at me, and I will try to respect it. People online, you can chat, and we'll make the sign at me. Okay, so here is the representation of on. And I told you that everything was a sign, a pairing of form and meaning. That's maybe not quite true here because we're representing this one as semantically empty. And so all it's doing in the meaning is passing up the index of its complement.
It's not the only entry for on.
it is not the only interferon. Thank you. Yeah, this is the somatic antion that gets used in this case where it's idiosyncratically selected by the lie. And we find that many English prepositions have this dual life with a semantically empty use and a contentful use. So then we have phrase structure rules. And this is just the form side of the phrase structure rules. So the first one is the head complement rule, and it says you can build a phrase by combining a head, that's what the bold-faced H means there, with everything it specs on its comps list. And I will come back to what these box numbers mean a little bit further in. And then we have the head specifier rule that says you can build a phrase by combining a head that's looking for a specifier and is not looking for any complements, that's what the empty list means there, with, to its left, anything that matches what's on its specifier requirement. So these are constraints on the form of phrases. They don't say anything about head values because we reuse these rules across different head structures. Okay, so the head specifier rule in the Sagwasso-Bender textbook, which is sort of a simplified grammar fragment, builds both S constituents and NP constituents, and the head complement rule does PPs and VPs and noun plus complement combinations, adjective plus complements, and that one being robust in general actually survives all the way into the big grammar.
Just a question.
Yes?
It said that maybe it's a stupid question, but anyway, will the meaning of a specifier become clearer, or am I missing some background here?
Ah, so the meaning of specifier will become clearer. Let me try to give a quick answer to that. This is sort of drawing on the X-bar theory notion, but the idea is that there's two different kinds of argument dependence in languages, and we distinguish between complements and specifiers. As we scale this up to the kind of broad coverage that we see in the ERG, in fact, we distinguish further between specifiers and subjects. So there's actually three kinds of arguments, complement, specifier, and subject. In this world, the specifier is the subject of a verb phrase, the determiner in a noun phrase. In the bigger picture, the subjects of verb phrases get picked out separately, and specifiers are things like determiners inside noun phrases and degree specifiers of adjectives and maybe some other interesting stuff in numeral constructions. Hopefully that helped. Thank you. So here's the principles that I promised a little while ago. That was just the form side of the phrase structure rules. On the meaning side, we have the semantic compositionality principle and the semantic inheritance principle. The semantic compositionality principle says that rels list, stands for relations, on the mother is the append of all the rels lists on the daughters. So we're going to gather up the semantic contribution of all the daughters. And the semantic inheritance principle says the index on the mother comes from the head daughter. Again, this is the slightly simplified Sagwasso-Bender view of the world. These get a little bit more complex in the English resource grammar. I think Dan's going to show us a little bit of them and what it looks like in the big picture. But the idea here is that the big picture idea is that the phrase structure rules are also talking about meaning. And in this very simplified view, what they do about meaning is they say, we're going to gather up the contributions of the daughters and make that what's going on in the mother. As we look into more complex grammar fragments, we find that, in fact, sometimes the phrase structure rules contribute meaning of their own, taking the idea from construction grammar. And so at that point, the semantic compositionality principle gets one more argument to that append relation, which is the constructional content of the rule itself. For those who have walked in because they're coming from other classes, the grammar that I'm showing you here is mostly the Sagwasso-Bender textbook grammar, just so that I have something consistent to rely on. And we will see construction semantics and other wonderful things, or possibly in the English resource grammar, depending on which phenomena we look at. Okay, so here's that tree again that I showed you from the beginning. Because I don't have my presenter notes, this is something, the free meeting will end in 10 minutes, so we might need to restart it, and that happens when we
leave,
though. The first time I showed you this tree, I had notes to myself to say, I hope you're wondering, why this tree and not any others? How do we make sure we get just that preposition? How do we make sure we don't get ungrammatical variants? Because these are things that you should wonder when someone shows you a tree. Where does that tree come from? So now I've started to answer those questions, which I forgot to ask you, by showing you the phrase structure rules. Right? So in this tree, these two are licensed by the head complement rule from a couple slides ago, and this one's licensed by the head specifier. And that works because the preposition is looking for a complement so it can fit in as the head daughter and head complement rule. Likewise, the verb is looking for a PP complement, and so it can fit in as the head daughter there. and that builds a VP that's still looking for a specifier so it can fit in as the head daughter of the head specifier. So we're still working on the big picture idea of science, which means we're talking about form and meaning at every step along the way. Here's the semantics associated with the VP node. The sentence, remember, is Kim relies on Sandy, but the VP is relies on Sandy. So at the point that we built that VP, all that we've gathered up so far are these two predications. Yes?
Maybe I do have a question about the previous slide.
Okay.
So if we had a language where we had head initial VPs and head final PPs, mm-hmm. how would you model that in the head comp rule?
Okay, so if you have a language where the headedness and head complement rule is not consistent, you would need two different head complement rules. And then you would constrain the head daughter's value, the part of speech, to make sure the only right ones go through. And we actually saw that, interestingly, in Japanese. Japanese is pretty resolutely head final. But when we built the big implemented grammar JC, which is not nearly as big as the ERG, but it's still a fairly large scale, we found a few places where we actually did want head medial constructions. And one of them is the number names, which look strikingly like the English and Chinese number names. And so we have things like the word for 100, which takes the tens complement to its right. And when I built that analysis, I ported everything over from the English grammar and then hit go, and none of the examples parsed. And I realized because I only had complement head phrase, and I didn't have the head complement phrase, and I had to add one. So at that point, you add it, and then you constrain it to make sure it doesn't overapply. Other questions? All right. So here is the more complicated example. With these node labels V/NP, that's an abbreviation showing that that is basically a gappy verb, and above that, S/NP is a gappy sentence. And the NP is what's missing. And that slash notation goes back to the GPSG days. And this feature that we're seeing called gap is called slash also in the HPSG literature for that reason. So on this one, the semantics of the S node, that's the node at the top that has everything. So Kim knows Sandy baked these cookies, is what that said. But the S/NP node, the one that hasn't picked up these cookies yet, we have Kim knows Sandy baked something, but that X5 isn't linked to anything yet because we haven't picked it up. So again, big picture idea is everything is a pairing of form and meaning. The lexical entries are, the phrase structure rules are, and the licensed phrases are, even when you haven't gotten to the top of the tree. I said all that. Okay, on to typed feature structures. Feature structure, and I've been showing you feature structures without saying that word very much, is a collection of feature value pairs, which describes a set of objects in the modeling domain which satisfy its constraints. It's typically an underspecified model of the thing that it's describing, and I have this long example in my intro syntax class where I use a model of pizza preferences to motivate both feature structures and underspecification and unification, because it's an example in the real world where you want to combine constraints. But that wasn't going to fit in today's lecture. So we're talking about linguistic objects only. The values of features in a feature structure can be either atomic symbols, so something like third, in person third, or they can themselves be feature structures. So we get this recursive thing that I've been showing you already. So here's a really simple example, and now I am going to make you talk some. Here's a feature structure. What kind of words is this feature structure a partial description of?
You can give them a hint about what per and num mean.
These are linguists.
All right, they can guess.
They probably have a guess about what per and num mean.
Right.
He. He? Okay, so this is a partial description of the word he. Okay. Are there phrases that it might be a partial description of? Yeah, so for example?
He sings.
He sings, okay, or sings a song, because we're going to talk about verbs as having person number value also. In the following the Sog-Wasserbender analysis of agreement, which I don't love, but that's the analysis I have here. It is also a partial description of phrases like the cat. Right? So in what ways is this description possibly underspecified with respect to those objects? We take he. We say this is a partial description of the pronoun he. What's it missing?
It's missing a gender.
It's missing a gender, all right? So we're probably imagining a bigger feature structure where there's person number information down inside of it. And in English, when you're talking about third person singular pronouns, there's also that gender feature that's not there. All right, so we have partial description, it can be a word, it can be a phrase, and partial description means under specification, and you can imagine what other information might be. All right, so that was just feature structures, and you see feature structures actually in lots of frameworks. HPSG takes the idea and runs with it, and the first mountain we climb on that run is the notion of types. So when we add types to the notion of feature structures, that allows us to specify which features are appropriate for which types, in other words, which features co-occur. And so person and number and maybe gender belong together in the same part of things, but person and tense maybe don't necessarily belong in the same place. Okay? It also allows us to specify which values are appropriate for which features and on a given type. So person third, that makes a lot of sense. Tense third, not so much. Okay? And so we can build that into our model. And the types are organized into a type hierarchy that allows us to talk about inheritance of constraints. And so we are inheriting both the feature appropriateness and feature values from supertypes, and then we can put also further constraints on unification. That's all a mouthful. Let me give you some examples. So here's feature co-occurrence. The last key idea, right, everything's signs, is implemented as saying, okay, well, we have this notion of a type SynSem, which is going to be the supertype for words and phrases. And it has the features syn and sem. And those features are appropriate for all things of type SynSem. And then the possible values for syn and sem are these sort of bland types, syncat and semcat, that mainly serve to introduce the further features that are on the syntax or semantic side of things. So down inside of syncat, we have a feature of val for valence. And the value of val is valcat, and then valcat is constrained to say, well, I have these three features, specifier, comps, and mod. So what I'm looking for is a specifier, what I'm looking for is a complement, or what I could modify if I am a modifier. And all of those are constrained to have lists as their value, and specifically lists of things of type expression, and expression is going to be the supertype of a word and phrase. All right? So SynSem up there in the Sagwasso Bender grammar fragment is the supertype to lexemes, which are used together with lexical rules that we'll see later to generate lexical entries or lexical sequences, we call them. But you know, the things, the words, all right? And then also expressions. And our expressions are what get to go play in the syntax, and those are other words or phrases. But all of those inherit from SynSem, so they all have the features syn and sem because they are all signs. I'm nodding as though you're nodding back to me, entrainment. It's useful. So in this example, every single node there in the tree is an expression. So the P and the VP and everything are all things of type expression that have the features syn and sem. And I've just hidden all that information in these abbreviated node labels for now to get the simpler view of the tree. Questions? Another example to illustrate the notion of feature and feature value inheritance is we can put constraints on lexical types. So we have this type here, CNLXM, which stands for common noun lexeme. And it has the constraint that down inside its form side of things, in syn, the head value has the type noun and the agger information person third. So saying that in slightly more like English, I'm saying all common nouns are nouny and third person. All right, is Fabiola still in the room?
Fabiola?
We just got booted out of the Zoom thing. Should I log back into it?
Yeah.
All right. Can you log into Zoom again on yours and I'll do mine? Try. I think it's just a matter of clicking on it again. Enforced attention break.
Yep. Zoom, sign in.
Oh, I think you just click on the link. So, go back to the mail, and it should give you a join. And we have to make sure we're muted everywhere but yours.
Can you mute?
No.
Yeah, stress screen, and then I think it was that same one that's working. Okay, we're back. Okay, that was a really quick recovery. We get to do it again in another 40 minutes.
There'll be a break then.
Feature structures allow us to do. It allows us to tell us which features are appropriate for which types, but then also tells us which features co-occur. It allows us to specify which features, which values are appropriate for which features. And it allows us to specify inheritance. So types inherit from their supertypes, which features are appropriate, and any constraints on the values of those features. What I haven't talked about yet is further constraints on unification. And the reason for that, and I really don't need two videos going with me, maybe there is. Okay, we can see moving triangles, lovely. So the further constraints on unification I haven't talked about because I have to first explain unification. So that's the next part. So key idea number four, we are humming along here, this is great, is unification. So an HPHT grammar consists of partial constraints on well-formed trees. And the idea is that you combine these constraints via the operation of unification, and any combination that succeeds licenses well-formed utterances. And I have a very distinct memory of Paul Kay in my first ever syntax class, which was a construction grammar class, illustrating the same idea by talking about erector sets. Right? So the idea is that you're looking at a sentence and you're trying to decide if it's grammatical, and you have this set of pieces in front of you, okay, which is your erector set. And Paul Kay, in his very Paul Kay way, would say, can I make that with my erector set? Right? So you try putting the pieces together to see if you can make the sentence you're looking at, and if yes, it's grammatical, and if no, your grammar says it's ungrammatical. So what are the pieces? The pieces are lexical entries and phrase structure rules, and we've seen some examples of that already. Also lexical rules, which I've been promising but I haven't shown you yet. The general principles, of which we've seen a couple. And also the initial symbol. So the idea is you put the whole thing together, but is it something that can stand on its own, like these cookies Sandy knows Kim baked? Or is it something that's not yet ready to be on its own, like Sandy knows Kim baked, which is still missing something? And so the initial symbol is this last filter saying, hey, if we don't match that, then that's a possible piece of a sentence, but it's not a whole sentence.
I have a question for you.
Yeah.
What's an example of a lexeme that's not an expression?
An example of a lexeme that's not an expression is a lexical entry that's not inflected yet, with required lexical rules, and so it can't go play in the syntax. And it's hard to come up with a compelling example in English because we have such poor morphology. But if you think briefly about Italian, where both the singular and the plural of nouns are marked, you can say, all right, you got the root, piz, P-I-Z-Z, right? And that's the lexeme. And then when you inflect it with a to get the singular, then it's pizza, which is a word, or a for the plural pizza is a word, but pizza by itself isn't. So that's an example. All right.
Scissor might be a word like that, which, almost.
Almost.
Or yeah. The wood of the woods is in the forest.
Okay. Yeah. So the sort of words that are required to show up in plural, but we might still analyze them as going through the plural lexical rule, so we can see that the stem by itself is not fully inflected. Okay, so I have an informal definition of the operation of unification for you here. It's actually really simple and intuitive. There's also the formal definition that I'm not going to go through, but it's on the slides if you want to go look at it later. Adds up to the same thing. So the informal definition is, you take two feature structures. If they contradict each other, then unification fails. Right? The result of the unification operation is the empty set or the fail symbol. Otherwise, you create a new feature structure that contains just the information from each of them and nothing more. That's what unification is. So here's some examples. If we're unifying person, third, and number singular, first question, do they unify? Yes? Okay. What's the result? Person, third, number singular. Okay. What if I unify number singular and person third? Same. Okay. This operation is commutative, doesn't care what order the arguments come in. How about person third number singular and person third? Also unifies, what's the result? Same, okay? So these are consistent, we're taking all the information from both and nothing more. We have the two copies of the same information, that's fine. How about second number singular and person third? Those don't unify, they contradict each other, so the answer is the empty set. All right, it gets a little bit more complicated with types, but not much. First, we have once we're talking about the recursive feature structures, two feature structures are consistent if they are of compatible type, and for any features present in both of them, the values of those features are consistent. But those values might be complex feature structures, so you recursively call unification. Now, two types are compatible if they're the same type, one is a subtype of the other, or they share a mutual subtype. And those three bullet points can actually all be summarized as types unify the subtype. So, examples. Here's a non-linguistic example, not pizza, sorry. Here is a little type hierarchy of animals, all right? And I can say, what would animal and bee unify to? If one input says animal, one says bee, what's the result?
Fire?
It's actually not fire. It's not animal.
Bee.
It's bee, all right? So why is it not animal or fire? It's because the operation of unification says take all of the information present in both and add nothing more, right? Bee as the subtype is more specific than animal. And so you need that information in bee as part of your input. And so if you back up to fire or back up to animal, you've lost information. How about if we unify a swimmer and vertebrate? We get fish, because types unify the subtype. So here's a case where when we take all of the information present in both, we actually get something that looks like it was in neither. But what we know about swimmers is that it includes the class of fish, and what we know about vertebrates is that it includes the class of fish, and so that unifies to fish. And then finally, if we're going to unify flyer and vertebrate, we don't have any flying vertebrates in this model. We forgot to model birds. Yeah. Right?